Hello, Melrose, and welcome to the Brodeur Bulletin. I'm your mayor, Paul Brodeur, and I'm here today with Dr. Julie Kukenberger, our superintendent, and our health director, Ruth Clay, to talk about a subject you've heard a lot about from me and my partners here at the table, and that is COVID-19. And we are here today to make sure folks understand that while it's been, you know, 6 or 8 months fighting the pandemic, we need to keep up the good work if we're going to continue our progress, keep our numbers down, and make sure we're giving our kids the best education we can. I'm going to start with Dr. Kukenberger. Doctor, welcome.
Happy to be here.
Your first Melrose podcast. I think you've probably done one or two in the past. Let's start with, how's it going, and where are we at with the state of the schools today?
Sure. Thank you for having me. So school's back in session. Today is day 4, our first official day in the hybrid rotation for our kindergartners and first graders. So they're having a full day of school today. And things are off to a great start. We've been able to work in partnership with the IT department that we share with the city and making sure that families are getting all the tech support that they need. We've put some infographics out to help families navigate tech issues. And we've also hosted some parent university kind of educational forums, if you will. And that's been led by our media literacy teacher. So we're getting started. There's still lots of little details that will get worked out as students start coming back, but so far so good. Most importantly, I would also highlight the work that has been done throughout the summer to do our normal deep summer clean, but then also in partnership with the Department of Public Works, we've been able to really step up some of our cleaning protocols. We've added some additional staffing. There's floor decals in all of the schools marking which directions students should travel, also reminding them to keep physical distance. So you know that here in the Melrose Public Schools, we decided to exceed the minimum expectations of 3 feet, and we've gone with 6 feet seat to seat and reminding staff and students to stay 6 feet apart throughout the day. We also outfitted every classroom that's in person with a COVID cleaning and care kit. So inside those kits, there's disposable student masks, adult masks, clear masks for teachers if they'd like to try those out. Every classroom has a gallon of hand sanitizer. We also have buckets of wipes, disinfectant wipes that teachers can use to clean high touch surfaces like doorknobs and things like that. What else do we have in those care kits? Spray bottles. So we are using soap and water for cleaning during the day so that students can have access to that if they want to clean their area. And we're putting smaller little hand sanitizer bottles in there as well so that students can use them throughout the day, in addition to washing their hands. Our first line of defense, of course, is hand washing. And most of our elementary classrooms have sinks in them. And so we've been able to make sure that they're all outfitted with paper towel dispensers and soap, which doesn't sound like a big deal, but we did have to go around and make sure that every sink in the had. And then we made some really nice signs printing from the CDC website that are really clear and consistent across all of our schools. So no matter what school you come in, you have the same visual cues.
Awesome. Director Clay, I got a question for you. And that is about, so we know that when you think of schools, you obviously think of students, staff, faculty. But the group you head up on, as part of your responsibilities, is the school nurse team. Can you talk about their role kind of in normal times and how they're helping out in terms of COVID?
Great. Thanks for having me. Yes, the school nurses are part of the health department, but work in the schools. They're part of the school teams, but the health department is able to provide a lot of technical support. So it's been working out really, really well, especially during COVID and actually because I've been here long enough during H1N1. So for COVID, the school nurses actually did a lot of the contact tracing in the spring when schools closed and the nurses were working from home. They helped our public health nurse do a lot of the contact tracing. Some of them worked over the summer, actually most of them worked over the summer with the school department working on health and safety guidelines. And now that they're back in school, they're doing basically double duty with their regular nursing duties with the students, but also also helping us with COVID-19 and flu preparations and shots. So we couldn't do it without the school nurses.
No question.
So I know people hear a lot from the governor's office about the community tracing program that is available to us, but we have not needed to use that because we have the local resources.
So Dr. Kukenberger and Ruth, there is something that I know is a lot on a lot of parents' minds. I have a son who's a junior in school. He's doing the remote right now, but we'll be doing the hybrid model as soon as that's possible. What happens if a student does test positive? And maybe, why don't we hold on that for a second? Because one thing we talked about in the PSA, but we should probably reiterate, is what are the steps, we are asking students and parents to do in order to keep schools safe?
Sure. So our schedule actually is designed to mitigate as much risk as we can. That's really been our mantra throughout the whole summer in the planning process. And so our hybrid rotation is 5 days in-person learning, 5 days learning from home. And what that allows for is 9 days in between cycles when you count the 2 weekends. And that really is designed so that families can monitor their students and notice if they develop any symptoms before they come back to the school community. In addition to that, we're asking families every day to do a wellness check of their students. And we've provided a Google form that we're using right now. We're looking at some applications, maybe once we bring more students back, just to kind of scale up the process. But in collaboration with our nurses, we're asking families to work through the common COVID symptoms and to notice if their child has any of the symptoms on the list to keep them home from school. We always want students to stay home when they're sick. We always want staff to stay home when they're sick. But now it's more important than ever that everyone does their part so that we can ensure we're staying in school longer.
And the staff's doing the wellness check as well?
The staff went through a training during those first 10 days that reminded them of their daily responsibility to be, examining themselves, making sure that they're staying home if they have symptoms or if they've been exposed to someone who has tested positive for COVID-19.
And Ruth, it's fair to say that these, those precautions that Julie just described kind of go for everyone, meaning if you're active in your own workplace, not working from home, if you come into contact with the hand washing, the masks, all that stuff applies to everyone, correct?
Absolutely. And the we touched upon contact tracing, and that's basically what we do. So if anybody who lives in Melrose or lives in Wakefield, because we're a joint health department, tests positive, we are notified through a statewide electronic surveillance system. So people ask us, how do you know when somebody's positive? And there's two ways. One is our public health nurse checks that that website probably 4 or 5 times mm-hmm. a day. But also people tell us, and sometimes we find out first from the person because they find out and it's maybe the next day it shows up in the electronic surveillance. So as soon as somebody tells us that, we actually double check it to make sure that it's a real positive. And then we start our process, which is two things, case management and contact tracing. So case management is when we work with the person themselves who has tested positive. And we go through a multi-page questionnaire with them talking about symptoms, if they have any, when symptoms started, and a timeline of who they have been a close contact with within their infectious period. So then we get into close contacts. A close contact is somebody that you have spent more than 15 minutes with indoors within 6 feet. That's a close contact. So we work to identify who those people are. We talk to the person, we give them prompts about things maybe they didn't think about. It's one of the reasons when you come into City Hall, we take your name and phone number. You may have seen that when you go out to dinner or in other stores, people are keeping track of who's been where. Again, that's so that if there's a positive, that helps us with the contact tracing. Mm-hmm. Every person who is identified as a close contact gets a phone call from a nurse from the health department. It may be the public health nurse, it may be one of our school nurses, but they get a phone call from a nurse. They are put into quarantine for 14 days. So those people need to stay home, as in stay home home, preferably in a separate part of the house with a separate bathroom, if that's possible, for 14 days. People that they have been in contact with, and we get a lot of calls about this, are fine. They don't need to quarantine. It's just the person who is positive, who is isolated, what we say isolated, for 10 days and close contacts for 14 days. And even if that person gets tested while they're doing their 14-day quarantine and they test negative, it doesn't matter. They still have to stay with the 14 days. And if there's a student or staff at the school, we do exactly the same process.
Okay, let's pivot. Let's pivot to that, Dr. Kukenberger. That is mentioned it before. That is a question that is on everyone's mind. What happens if a student or a staff member tests positive? What does the school do? Who is going to find out? What are the details? Because there's a lot of concern about that, and there's also some some frustration with the way the process works. There are good reasons for the process being laid out the way it is, but knowing how it works is so helpful to folks having peace of mind. So what happens?
Yeah, I agree, Mayor. And I do think that's one of the biggest challenges, is that there's always going to be someone who feels like they should get to know information that they're just not going to be privy to. And so there is a lot of confusion. And the first thing that we're going to do when we find out that a student or a staff member is positive is contact the Department of Health and start that process with them. We are not the ones doing the contact tracing. We're going to rely on the health experts to do that. And then it depends, you know, where were they when they found out they were positive? Is it when they're learning from home? There's going to be a different protocol for that than if they were in school. Obviously, there's a different protocol for that. All of our schools have been set up with, we have our clinics, which is the nurse's office, but then we also have medical waiting areas so that if a student is developing symptoms or a staff member during the day, while they're waiting for someone to pick them up or for their ride to come, they're going to be placed in that medical waiting area. And all of the medical waiting areas in the clinics have been outfitted with additional air purification systems. So there's HEPA air purification systems in both the clinics and the medical waiting areas. So the first thing we're going to do is take care of the student and make sure that they're safe, make sure they have what they need while they're waiting to be picked up. And then depending on where that student has been throughout the day, we are going to have to either evacuate a classroom space in order to have it cleaned, depending how close of a contact they've been with other students in the class. There might be other students who need to go home. And it's really just going to be a case-by-case scenario, starting with lots of questions and remembering that, you know, it's not an emergency when we find out this information. We really have time to be thoughtful and careful and follow our protocols. We are also disinfecting the schools every day. So when students leave, we are asking our staff members to leave the buildings by 4 p.m., which is hard for teachers. You know, they put in lots of late hours. But we're doing that so that the schools can efficiently and effectively be cleaned. And so DPW has increased staffing levels so that we have access to more custodians and to disinfect the schools each night. And then on the weekends, in between cohorts, there's also a whole nother level of disinfection, again, trying to mitigate the risk. But when a student or a staff member tests positive and they're in the building, the first thing we're going to do is get them isolated, contact the Department of Health, and start that contact tracing process.
So, Director Clay, the what-ifs, you know, the committee. So, if I have a student, say, who is a kindergartner and a student in fifth grade. Am I necessarily going to hear, you know, what is going to happen to my fifth grader?
Right. Right. So we're talking about a case of a confirmed positive. So everybody who lives in that household is considered a close contact. Mm-hmm. So if they have siblings, their siblings will go home also because they may have tested positive but not have any symptoms, so they may be in school. So at that point, we work with the school department. We would identify any siblings. The parents would be notified to come pick up the kids. We would start the case management for the family as well as the contact tracing. The contact tracing involves getting a layout of the classroom of who sits where. And because, as Dr. Kukenberger said, everybody's going to be 6 feet away and the teacher will be 6 feet away, ideally there won't be any further quarantine for the classroom. And then we would just do our regular contact tracing with the family.
So in the ordinary course, if there's an incident at a school, there's not going to be building-wide notice, and there are, I think it's important for folks to understand that, but also understand that there's good reasons for that, that folks that are at risk, if their children, their students are at risk, the way the protocols work is you will be notified if you are at risk, and you won't be notified if the risk, there's no such thing as no risk, but if the risk is extremely low, you're not necessarily going to get that information, right?
If you're a close contact, you will hear. If you don't hear from us, you're not a close contact. Mm-hmm. We do have charts, and the superintendent has a chart from DESE about what we would do if there's more than one student in a class.
DESE is the Department of Elementary and Secondary Education, right?
Right. So, or the Department of Ed, as we just call them. So we have laid out algorithms, basically, that tell us what to do if there's more than one student in a classroom, more than one student in the same building, multiple cases in multiple buildings. So, we do that for the whole community. So people do look and should look on the state's website, mass.gov, for the Melrose data that's updated every Wednesday at the end of the day. And, you know, we could have an uptick in cases, but it may have nothing to do with the school department. None of those cases may have children. So it's important to look at the numbers, but we also look beyond the numbers as to who they are and whether they have common sources.
And that, and again, that informs your contact tracing, your communications on a kind of on an as-needed basis, even though that can be frustrating sometimes for folks out in the public.
Right. Now, there may be times where we're notified of a positive student before the school department knows about it. Mm-hmm. And at that time, we would contact the school. We would already have been talking to the family so that the student is not in school. But this is one of those cases that Dr. Kukenberger was talking about when people are going to be asking for information that we cannot give them. Mm-hmm. So that's why I mentioned early the seating charts, because that way we can look at a seating chart and know who could be or would be a close contact, but we cannot tell the schools, unfortunately, who the student is. Mm-hmm. Or the staff person.
Sure. Dr. Kukenberger, as we sit here today, we are on track for what I'll call full hybrid opening when?
So we'll enter into what we call our best fit model on October 19th. And what that is our students who are in Group C, who've already been coming back in person, they'll be in person all day, every day, every week. And then our K and 1 students are in the hybrid. On October 19th, if you're a family that requested the hybrid model for your student in grades 2 through 12, they will then start their hybrid rotation on October 19th. If you're a family who requested the Melrose Distance Learning Academy, the MDLA, then they'll stay in that fully remote distance learning model with their same classmates and their same teacher. And then Group C, of course, will continue coming in person.
So the reason why I say that is kind of a magic date, but it is not built on anything other than our ability as a community to maintain our low rates, to, you know, keep these best practices going in order to kind of move through the pandemic with as many kids in school as possible. And the reason why I bring it up is because folks need to understand this really is a community effort. Mm-hmm. You know, the masks matter, the social distancing matter, the sanitizing, the washing your hands, all that stuff matters. Maybe even if you don't necessarily have kids in school, you are doing your part by following those rules to help us keep kids in school and to help keep our community safe. Is that fair to say?
Absolutely.
Yeah, this is Ruth again, and I really want to emphasize that we're all tired of the whole COVID-19 thing. I get it. We all understand that. And it's so tempting to get together for birthdays or anniversaries. There's just been a lot of family events that haven't happened over the past 6 months. And now that the weather is turning cooler, more of those are going to be inside. And I can't emphasize enough how important it is to resist that temptation, because the cases that we're getting now are from people getting together socially. And we just have to take advantage. We're very lucky we have the technology we do at this point, between FaceTime and Zoom and WebEx and all the different platforms, so we can still see each other virtually. It does not substitute for a hug or a kiss of a loved one, but we really need to stay the course.
And to make it, let's make it a little more complicated. Let's talk about the flu for a little bit, because, you know, we are approaching our traditional flu season, which has the same kind, well, not the same, but infection vectors and all the things that make us concerned, and some overlapping symptomology that makes this all challenging. We've done flu clinics and things in the past. Things are a little bit different this year. What's the plan for this year?
Yeah, so things are going to be very different this year. We have been planning for the flu all summer, along with our COVID work, along with the state health department. So we in Melrose, we have received our flu vaccine, and the first people that we immunize are our elderly who are in elderly housing, and that is starting as we speak. And then we're having our first ever drive-through clinic on October 4th, which is a Sunday, from 9 to noon in front of the middle and high schools. Enter the high school parking lot from Melrose Street. And the forms will be online. You can fill it out there, or you can fill them out in advance and bring them with you, which will certainly speed things up. So we've never done that in this format, but I'm looking forward to it. I think we have done two testing events at that same site that worked really well. We'll be using the same model. We'll have at least four nurses giving flu shots at the same time. This one will be for people 19 and older. So that's October 4th, 9 to noon, in front of the middle and high school. The other thing we're doing, which is also new for us, is we're getting a vaccine from the state health department for people up to the age from 2 to 18. And we're going to be holding family clinics at the schools. Again, this is new for us. The first one we are going to hold at the middle school. We're waiting. We've got the approval for the vaccine. We're waiting for it physically to arrive before we schedule the date. It will be announced through all of our normal social media. It will also be specifically announced through the school department, because all of our students need to be immunized by December 31st, which is new, and we're trying to give families an opportunity to make this an easier process, whereby parents and their kids can all get immunized at the same time instead of having to make appointments at different places for different people in the family. So we will do one, big one, hopefully, at the middle school. We'll see what the demand is. And if there continues to be demand beyond that, we will move them around to different schools. So we will provide opportunities for all of our families, including families whose kids don't go to Melrose schools. We have a number of students who go to private schools in the area, and they are definitely welcome, which is why we're advertising it beyond just through the school department. And we're looking forward to, we will have nurses who are particularly trained with pediatrics. Not all nurses are comfortable with immunizing kids. Our nurses will be, are. And it will provide, an awesome opportunity to do something different that I'm hoping will be really helpful to our families.
And Dr. Kukenberger, I want to ask you about this, because part of the regimen that Ruth just referred to is the youth requirement. That is a prerequisite, as I understand it, for continuing to go to any public school in the Commonwealth. Is that correct?
So students are required to be immunized on schedule, and we don't yet know what the implications will be for families who don't elect to get the flu vaccine by December 31st, but we're hoping that most will take advantage of it, especially here in Melrose, where it's being made so convenient for folks to do so. We're also hoping that because everyone's washing their hands a lot and wearing masks and keeping physical distance, that we'll see less people getting the flu. So it could be
That's a great point, because all the things that we talk about in terms of preventing the spread of COVID work very well for flu, correct?
Absolutely. And we do base our flu seasons on the flu seasons in the Southern Hemisphere, because their summer is our winter and our winter is their summer. So actually, the Southern Hemisphere this past year did have a relatively light flu season, if that's any indication.
Good news.
That would be great. And if people remember back to last winter, which seems like an eternity ago, people at that point were tested for flu. And then if the flu test was negative, it went and was tested for COVID. So I imagine it'll be something similar to that.
Well, I want to thank you both for coming on and sharing your thoughts and really important information. Folks need to, again, I just want to remind people, this really is a community effort. And I also need to remind folks to stay tuned, because if we've learned nothing in the last 6 or 8 months, it's that things change. And the way we deal with COVID, the way we react with, the way we try to prevent it may change. So please stay tuned through certainly through the city channels, through your own medical providers, and do your best to keep the community safe and healthy, and we will get through this. I want to thank Health Director Ruth Clay and our superintendent, Dr. Kukenberger, for their generous supplying of their time and their energy and their skill. And I want to thank the folks at MMTV for continuing to support the city as we do our best to communicate about the pandemic. Thanks for listening.